Yeah, I'm Matthew Kingpin. I'm a snake. At least, my character is. The character I choose to present myself as on this vast ocean of personalities, or lack thereof, we call social media. You've seen them out there, furries, donning their anthropomorphic profile pictures that you might even have yourself, your own fursona, as they're called. But to someone outside of the whole sphere, there's this underlying question that pretty frequently gets asked, albeit rarely amicably. What is the interest in becoming a furry? Why do people choose to do so? And the answers you might get to that question, assuming you're not being a jerk about it and getting a joke response in kind, don't exactly share any level of congruency amongst members of the furry fandom. And I believe there's a good reason for that, mostly because the real answer is a bit difficult to come to grips with in our society with the way it is in the present day. So the purpose of this video will be to share my theory as to why people choose to, well, do all this furry stuff. It is unsafe to be gay in the modern world. That's the conclusion. I spoiled the buildup, I apologize. But the phrase itself is quite a loaded one, to say the least. So if you will allow me a moment of your time, I will do my best to explain my entire line of reasoning as to why this phrase is the reason for much of the furry fandom's prominence in the modern online space, should you be interested more in the why than the exact what.
Hey, post-production Matthew Kingpin here. Heads up, I used the term sexual deviant in this video multiple times, and to clarify what I mean by it, I'm using it strictly to refer to individuals outside of a heteronormative sexual orientation. So like lesbian, gay, pan, bi, etc. I looked it up while I was editing, just on a hunch that the terminology might have different meanings to different people, and it does, so that's the one I'm using. Anyways, back to the video.
To begin with, I will disclaimer that it is better to be a sexual deviant in today's political and social climate than it has been for many decades, if only marginally. However, that does not mean that it is still socially acceptable to be open about it in many spaces. Even if the consequences aren't being committed to a mental asylum or outright denial of your rights anymore, there's still a layer of social undesirability that gets leveraged towards the act of any outward expression of homosexuality. And certainly there exists interpersonal animosity amongst heteronormative individuals when it comes to interactions with homosexuals. To put that in less word-salady terms, I, for example, would have to contend with an immense amount of potential backlash if I were to ask out on a date just any random guy at a social gathering in a heteronormative setting. Even if he doesn't straight up deck me for the thought, a genuine possibility in some areas, I could be leveraged an immense amount of disgust for the thought. Ew, I'm not gay, you F-slur. Get away from me, you queer. Do I look like I swing that way? To give some example statements of the kind of hatred I could be levied. While I have no qualms with the act of being rejected, being hit with an extreme excess of homophobic vitriol just for the simple act of expressing, hey, I think you look nice, cute, handsome, etc., isn't exactly a reasonable response, as I hope those who are watching might come to agree with. And for those who don't see where I'm coming from, to provide a heteronormative point of reference, if you were to ask out a woman, and she were to respond with, get the hell away from me, you creep, provided you weren't hitting on her in an inappropriate place or way or asking multiple times, you know, provided you weren't actually being a creep, you'd also see that as an unjustifiable response to what amounts to a compliment at the baseline. But unfortunately, it's quite socially acceptable in many places and amongst many people groups to give an answer similar to the ones I used as examples in response to expressed interest. This outward disgust even extends to situations that would be considered supremely unremarkable, that is to say normal, in a heteronormative setting. Watching a show with another male friend and commenting, man, insert actress here absolutely slayed back then, dude, I'd kill for 5 minutes with her, doesn't have the same social consequences as, man, insert actor here is so damn handsome, in a heteronormative setting. The prior might get you a, if she's your type, bro, wow, at worst. The latter might cause your friend to act like you just claimed you support dog fighting. So what happens when you're not allowed to express yourself in a way congruous with your sexual preferences to the point where you have to heavily vet what most consider to be normal speech or acts in order to be straight passing? Which is a term that just means appearing heteronormative enough to not be immediately made into an outcast or judged. Well, you might just find that there's a group out there that's already packed to the brim with other sexual deviants who are more than accepting of those types of statements and advances. It may be an unspoken rule for the most part, but it's almost universally understood all the same. Most furries aren't straight. Even the straight ones don't react with incandescent malice off of the prospect of being approached by someone they aren't interested in. They simply just reply, "Hey, I'm flattered, but I don't swing that way," or the emotional equivalent in probably less refined words. But the animosity normally expected from a heteronormative setting is scarce to non-existent in most straight furries, the few that there are. Considering sexuality is something that is on the forefront of many individuals' minds, especially people freshly entering adulthood, it's liberating to be able to express that sexuality without fear of backlash. Now, all this is well and good, but some viewers might offer a bit of a counterpoint to my theory that our homophobic society is the root cause of the furry fandom's propagation with the sentiment of, well, there already exists gay communities, gay bars, clubs, and venues, gay advocacy groups, etc., ones that have existed for many decades now on top of that. Why would the furry fandom become this necessary escape for the average young gay man? And my answer to that is, one of the greatest enemies to an individual's expression of homosexuality is a far more unseen force that many do not consider at all in their assessment of what drives their own sexual expression. And that's the voice inside one's own head, the force of socially induced, internalized homophobia. So how does one get from, "I can't accept that I'm gay," to, "I want to pretend to be a wolfman on the internet"? It's a pretty big leap if you go straight from the first point to the last, but my dear viewer, with the power of context, I guarantee I can seamlessly connect the two. So let's unpack what internalized homophobia even means to start out. Internalized homophobia, as I define it, would constitute any words, actions, or thoughts that suppress any feelings of sexual deviance, either through means of coercion, self-sabotage, shame, deflection, projection, denial, or any other usual method of control. So basically, any type of action you can think of that homophobic individuals conduct onto members of the gay community, except the perpetrator and the victim, are one and the same. In even fewer words, hatred for your own preferences or even existence as a whole. So if someone who hates the fact that they are gay is, well, gay, how are they supposed to come to grips with this truth? Many don't ever get the opportunity to do so, whether that be because they never allow the thought of being homosexual to escape their subconscious or otherwise, but others might resort to, well, for lack of a better term, cheating, in order to fulfill their underlying desires, if they can't resolve their internalized homophobia either in part or outright. And to clarify, I don't mean cheating as in, you have a partner and you decide to do things with another person that's outside of the relationship. I mean cheating more so like, oh, you're cheating in a game. In regards to the furry fandom, this cheating comes in the form of looking at furry art, generally known for oftentimes extremely cutely designed and drawn characters, who on top of that are more often than not far more gender androgynous than men in reality. Your knee-jerk reaction might be to recoil at the thought of furry characters are a gateway drug to enjoying real-life men, mostly because it's the type of argument that a lot of homophobes like to use in a malicious way to discount the fandom in its entirety. But to change the language into something with far less of a negative connotation, for someone who is having trouble coming to grips with what they actually like in a sexual context, furry art, and the furry fandom in kind, is a useful mental catalyst to getting some individuals to come to accept their own sexual deviance. If someone needs to essentially take baby steps in order to accept who they actually are and what they actually want, if someone has to go from liking cis women, to hermaphrodites, to feminine men, to masculine men, etc., as an example of their personal sexual pipeline, then that is simply just the journey that individual has to take in order to not cause themselves the extreme amount of mental distress and agony internalized homophobia can ravage onto their psyche. Which, mind you, can be immense depending on the severity of that societally programmed level of homophobia. I know, in my own personal experience, it took me literal years to understand internally not only what I wanted out of a partner, but to be able to even express what I wanted outwardly without an extreme psychological negative response of either shame or disgust at myself. So if someone has to call themselves a furry and hang out with other furries in order to eventually be okay with being gay, much like I had to, then the associated fandom has a useful utility in allowing them to do so. This isn't the reason everyone joins this fandom, but it is the reason I would say most people join this fandom, whether they are consciously aware of it or not. It explains why so many furries tend to lean towards sexual deviance. It explains why so many furries are essentially man-children, referencing all the drama, juvenility, and the less desirable parts of the fandom. Because most furries are essentially having to do the kind of personal growth and development most get the luxury of experiencing figuring out in their teen years as adults. My theory, I like to think, holds a huge amount of credence once it's examined with an open mindset. I can talk about any of those last points in more detail in a separate production if there's enough expressed interest in it, but for the purposes of this video, I'll end the discourse here and move on to my concluding thoughts. It isn't safe to be gay in the society of today. The furry fandom is a much-needed homosexual safe space in such a society. That's about all I have to say for this production. In case you need to hear this, it's okay to be gay. It's okay to like whatever consenting adult you like. You aren't forced to conform to anyone else's expectations in this world when it comes to loving another adult human being, so long as they genuinely feel the same. But since there's a huge amount of the opposite sentiment existing in society today, we have to come up with workarounds to allow ourselves the kind of acceptance and encouragement we as human beings are biologically inclined to desire and require. Being a furry is one of those workarounds. I wanted to keep this video brief and packed with as much relevant information per minute of length that I could, as to keep it informative without being bloated. If there's anything I brought up that you'd like talked about in more detail in another video, please feel free to give me those suggestions for things I should elaborate more upon. I will be happy to do so to the best of my ability. Anything else you'd like to comment on, either positive or constructive, please do so in the comment section below. I love reading those types of messages. It also helps me grow as a content creator and as a person, something I know I have a lot of room still left to do. I've enjoyed giving my thoughts today. Thank you all for watching and doing the typical YouTube things to help spread the word of the channel in the algorithm. If you'd like to stay up to date on new uploads, please consider joining the Discord server in the description. It is the only surefire way to actually be informed when I post, considering YouTube's super funny feature of just not telling my subscribers, the people who want to be informed of when I post. Anyways, burn your dread and have a peaceful night. Go into the future, and I'll meet you there.
Get up here. I'll even get a suppressed weapon just to complete the image.
Oh, that's a good pull up.
There's no way.
Oh, shit! He's going to turn around. He has to, because he has the bomb. Yeah, he's turning around on only 3. Bruh.
I don't care if we lost the round.
Yeah, that was... Yeah, you won the round. I don't care what they say.